Are there questions?
In field theory, so the definition of one PR diagram is when we cut one line, gets separated into diagrams. But here it is not necessary.
So if I define one PR diagram like that, exactly.
If we glue two punctures of the same,
that's not one PR.
That is not one.
That's one PR in field theory. It will be one PR here. So here also, exactly the way we find one PR and one PR diagrams in field theory, you can do the same thing here. That when you cut it propagated, if it falls apart into two parts, that will be declared as one particle reducible. Otherwise, it is one particle irreducible. Okay? So, field theory diagrams like these. Length or these. These are all one particle irreducible diagrams, right? Even though you have actually, from the string theory perspective, you have glue two punctures on the same Riemann surface. So these will be considered as one particle irreducible even in straight. Other questions?
Yes. So I had the impression that when you were discussing the three point function,
yes.
So you said there was a case with three NS functors and the case with two NS, so one NS and two
Riemann. Yes.
You don't have the other cases?
No, because the number of Riemann punctures is always even. Right? So you cannot have one Riemann puncture or three Riemann punctures. And the reason is essentially that the Riemann puncture creates a Z2 branch cut. Right? So that has to end somewhere. So if you have two Riemann punctures, then the branch cut can go like this. But if you have one or three Riemann punctures, then there is one Riemann puncture which is left, whose branch cut will flow at place to end. And that's why you cannot define amplitudes with odd number of Riemann punctures. And this of course fits in with the field theory intuition that we shouldn't have a vortex with odd number of particles. Right? We always have congruence in even number. Okay, there it follows from Lorentz invariance. Right? Here it's following from the Weierstrass Z2. Yeah, Riemann Raumschnitt is a spinner, right? So that of course these are correlated. But I'm saying even if you didn't know that Riemann Raumschnitt is a spinner, then also just by the fact that it creates a branch cut, you can see that you cannot have odd number of components.
So all the solid lines we had in the section, and we had dotted lines and we had solid lines.
Yes.
Solid lines are not necessarily one PR.
Well, solid lines are necessarily one PR. Solid lines are not necessarily, they can be one PI or one PR. Okay? Because the solid lines could come from diagrams like this part. Okay? Because this is obtained by gluing two objects. Okay? So this will be part of the solid line. Or they could come from diagrams like this. Okay, so solid lines do not necessarily belong to either 1PI or 1PR category. The dotted lines are always 1PI because they are the elementary vortices. Like by definition, they cannot be 1. Is this?
Can you say from that that it doesn't
contain any diagrams? It
doesn't contain any? Dotted part of this is
exactly. Yeah. Well, the divergent part always corresponds to, in this language, some propagator going outside. Right? Because if you think of the integration of the modulized space, that's the S going to infinity limit, right? Which is the degenerate region of the modulized space. Right? That's what causes the divergence. Right? And these parts, which you use to fill, by definition, do not contain any such contribution, all of those are included in diagram segments. Is this here? Yeah? Yeah, so this is the reason why this kind of just dividing the contributions into parts like this is useful, because this tells us clearly where you can expect divergences. Is there any questions? Okay, so today's lecture and probably tomorrow's will be essentially to precisely contradict what I claim here, that these do not contain any divergences. Okay, and we will see that these can contain potential divergences. Okay, even though there is no degeneration. And this is where the notion of spurious poles come in. So let me draw this figure again. So we have this PGMN, okay, whose base is the moduli space of genus G Riemann surface with m plus n punctures. Let me write it as MN, okay, m NS punctures and n Ramon punctures. And here you have a fiber direction which is local coordinates and PCOs. So spurious poles by definition are any singularities, and you will see that all of them are poles, any singularities of omega p in PGMN which do not arise from degenerate Riemann surface. Okay, because all those which are degenerate Riemann surface have already been isolated by reinterpreting in terms of finite dynamics. So these poles, these singularities can arise in principle inside the dotted region, which are part of the regular regions in the moduli space, and can potentially make the elementary vortices of string theory divergent. So I'll begin with some simple examples. And as you will see that these spurious singularities will involve essentially the PCOs, the locations of the picture sending operators. These will not be sensitive to the choice of local coordinates. So the simplest example one can think of is collision of two PCOs. Because if you take x of the domain times x of a 2, it is singular. I call this chi, right? Chi of the domain times x. Okay, you can easily check the OP with the expression for chi that I have given, and you will find that this OP is singular. This means that in the fiber direction, this is labeled by the position of the PCOs. And in this fiber direction, whenever you go to a subspace when two of the PCOs are at the same point, that corresponds to the singularity of the corresponding omega. But the integral will become singular. The integral, of course, after all, involves a correlation part. Second example, which is also based on the is collision of PCO. Yes.
PCOs are dimension zero operators. So
that's it. Yes.
Singularity in the corresponding operator would be negative dimension. So I'm not in the corner.
Yeah, there will be negative dimension, but the point is because you have a phi, right? So you take two product of two PCOs, it's in the picture number two, right? And in picture number 2, there are plenty of negative dimensions of order certain arrays. Then you can easily check. Because usually minus 2, 5, for example, is not, first of all, well, usually 2, 5. Right? One can check what the dimension of that is. And as you saw, on top of that, you can build states by acting with oscillators, which can have arbitrary negative dimensions. Right? So that's the reason why, even though they have dimension 0, right, the product of two of these can have poles. Well, they may not be in the cohomology, but you are not trying to describe it in general amplitude, right? Okay, then you are asked to worry about total derivatives and so on.
For off-cell,
yeah, for off-cell, it is certainly the first problem. For on-cell, you have to worry about total derivatives and two cells for life. Okay, so to add, to define the amplitude, it's not clear how to make it. I mean, if it's singular, right, then whether it vanishes at the end or not, that becomes an ambiguous question, because then you have to first regulate and then worry about other effects. Yeah, they are clearly the definition of omega, right? Yeah, it could. I mean, in PGMA, right? The PCO locations can vary by on the Riemann surface, right? So, in particular, on this in this direction, there are subspaces in which the PCO location is on top of the body. And there, the integral becomes singular. See, omega p involves a product of body supports and PCOs, right? The correlation function involves a product of body supports and PCOs. So, if the PCO location is on top of the body support, right? You can check the OP. And typically, it's a singular OP. Right? So the omega p becomes singular. Right? So there are subspaces of this, of PGMN, on which omega p becomes singular. Right? And you can also see what the dimension of the subspace is. Collision of two PCOs means that it's one complex condition. Zero one has to be equal to zero. Right? One complex condition, that's complex codimension 1 or real codimension 2. So on a real codimension 2 subspace in this big space, omega p becomes active. Is that clear? We are giving one complex condition on all the parameters of the of PGMN, right? That one complex condition here is either z1 equal to z2. But here it's the location of the PCO coincident with the on-body software. And that gives that.
As far as the on-shell amplitudes are concerned,
yes,
the first one will really not be a problem because it is up to us to choose where do I put the PCOs, right?
Yeah, except that it's not completely up to us because you see that these parts are already fixed by the order, right? So there are boundary conditions where the PCOs should be are fixed, right? So you have to see, subject to those boundary conditions, if you can choose PCOs here, it is true that it's up to us here.
Okay.
Right? But the boundaries are fixed, right? And given the boundary condition, we have to ask, is it possible to choose PCO locations over the full section? Okay. So as to avoid singularities. Right? And in general, you will see that it may not always be possible. Okay, when you draw some geometric picture, it will become clear that typically you will always run into singularities. Yes.
So it will fall over one PCO.
No, but you are not moving the PCOs, right? You're
saying that you can move it. Can you move it in such a way that they can move it?
Exactly. So the question is that we have singularities. See, what is the question? That we have singularities on a codimension 2 subspace. Right, of PGMA.
Okay.
We have to choose a section on a whole free integrate, right? Would we choose a section that doesn't integrate, that doesn't intersect that codimension 2 subspace? And that's a geometric question. Okay. You have to choose a section here to define your our amplitude. And typically, if you have a codimension 2 subspace on which the integrand is singular, it will intersect the section also on equal dimension 2 subspace. Is that clear? Right? Imagine that you have a big space of which equal dimension 2 subspace is singular. Right? You draw some section. That section will intersect that codimension 2 subspace over a codimension 2 subspace. Right? Because it's basically one, two real conditions on the coordinates. Right? It will translate to two real conditions on the coordinates of the section.
So, these
are collections
of
two codimension 2 subspaces? Yes, collection of codimension 2 subspaces. Right? But take any one of them. Right? And a section will intersect typically over a codimension 2 subspace. So it will intersect over many codimensional subspaces. Is this point clear? Okay. So as you said that you can choose the choice of PCO is up to us, but you have to make sure that it has right factor. So you cannot just choose completely arbitrary. Okay? So which means that the boundary conditions are fixed and given this, you have to see if you can fill. Satisfy the appropriate okay. Avoid this code dimension to some in singular subspaces. Okay, so now let me just have a more serious kind of spurious poles.
Does the second example mean that if we work with picture number 0, we will get this spurious singularity?
Yes, of course. If you take picture number 0, right, then you can show that if you take two picture number 0 vortex operators come close, then effectively you get singularity, it shouldn't be there.
But in the last class we saw that they arise when we consider degenerate surface.
Exactly.
But these are not from
So here the point is if we take picture number 0 on shell vortex operators, then these singularities are not there. Okay, you can check that if you take on shell vortex operators of the form C bar C V. Okay, where V is a matter primary of conformal matter primary. In fact, take NS sector, C bar C to the minus pi times V. So this is matter vortex operator of dimension 1/2. You can check that this is non-singular. The I of Z. But if you look at generic vortex operator, it can still be all shell, but you could add to it UB on something, right? This also, if you add to V, UB will recover. This is also on shell. This is also VRS invariant. But this one could have singularity when you bring chi of. So for spatial kinds of zero picture vortex, spatial kind of minus one picture vortex operator, you can get by, okay, by going to the zero picture without having a singularity when the PCOs are on top. But that is not always the case. Is this, yeah? Okay. Now the third kind of spurious pole, which do not appear in genus 0, these as you can see appear in any genus. The third kind of spurious poles appear from genus 1 onwards. And they come from some peculiarity of the xi eta phi correlated. Okay, I have to erase this before I get the space. Pardon? From g equal to 1 onwards. I'll write down the xi of phi correlation on the torus. But it can be easily generalized to a general genus J1 surface. In fact, if you remember Narayan's lecture, he did write down the general expression. Okay. What I'm going to write down is a spatial case of that of the torus, but the structure is more or less identical. So what you want to calculate is a large Hilbert space correlation function. And here is a formula. Notice that I have one more size than Eta's. This is written in large Hilbert space. Okay. Well, I had told you earlier that the Raman of size is one more than the Raman of Eta's. Okay, that's when the thing is non-zero. And furthermore, because we have the relation that sum over 2k is 2 times g minus 1. So g is a genus. So here it is 0. Okay, because if we are working at g equal to 1. In general, this similar formula exists for this being equal to 2. Yes. So. These are the Jacobi theta functions. It has. So this sum over I is equal to
for
y equal to infinity. You want me to do something else for y? Well, I can do it, but I'll probably get confused by the end. So it's understood that this is running from 1 to n plus 1 and this is running from 1 to n. Because here the product is from 1 to n plus 1. So if I have not specified the limits, it's also out of everything. Yeah, theta delta. So delta is a spin structure. Okay. So basically there are four spin structures, okay, which you can think of as 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, or 1, 1. Okay, or you use other notation. Delta is 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, the four theta functions. Four Jacobi theta functions. This sum is which sum?
This is this product. This
product is over j. This is yj. This sum subtraction is y. So you basically subtract one y at a time. Okay, and then there will be the prime forms. E x y is theta 1 prime x minus y, but theta 1 x minus y or theta 1 prime. So theta 1 is the Jacobi theta function which has a 0 at the 0 value. Okay, or in the Notice when I write theta alpha beta, this is theta 1 1. So Exy basically goes as x minus y. Goes as x minus y for x close to y. And you can easily verify that all the zeros and poles which are expected from the OP are encoded here. Okay, this input, that this, for example, when xi and xi prime are equal, xi is parabolic, so if you have a 0, you can see that there is a 0 here. Similarly, y and y prime equal, okay, there is a 0. When xi goes close to yj, that should be a pole, okay, which is here. And these are the singularities of these. This part, what is here, is necessary to ensure that these correlation functions have the right periodicity. For example, this ensures that this correlation function is periodic in the variable xi on the torus, periodic in the variable yi on the torus, okay, and has appropriate periodicity in the variable z. Those are not the idea. Because on the torus, they are here. Yeah, so that's why those things are not there. Right? On higher genus, they will be also so. Separately for phi and then xi. Okay. So what I say is that in large Hilbert space, the number of xi minus number of beta is equal to 1. Right? And the phi charge should add up to 2 minus 1.
And
those are
the two of the
yeah. So there are some nice properties of this, okay, which is not visible at all from this. So then it kind of took some work, why to actually prove all these properties. So, the most important property is the following. Okay, without which this formula does not make much sense. So, let's suppose that we apply the operator derivative operator on this correlation function in all the variables from 1 to n, okay, but not the last one. Okay, no derivative in xi n plus 1, but apply some derivatives in all the other variables. Okay, at least one. Okay, n I less than equal to 1. So it looks like a very complicated function, right? I mean, this is very complicated already. I'm going to start applying very, very subject. It will be a very complicated function. But what one finds that this is independent of xn plus 1.
So you said ni is greater than or equal to 1?
Yes, that zero derivative is not allowed. Okay, you have to have at least one derivative. Okay? And the reason that I am taking one derivative is because I want to bring these operators into the small Hilbert space. Small Hilbert space doesn't contain xi, right? So if you want to calculate correlation function in the small Hilbert space, you should apply derivatives. But you convert not all n plus 1 into small Hilbert space operators, but n of them into small Hilbert space operators. Okay? And what is surprising is that this object turns out to be independent of xn plus 1. This is independent of xn plus 1. Okay, we'll take a derivative of this with respect to all the xi's. Okay? At least once. From 1 to n. It's a complicated function of x1 to xn, right? And y. But what one can show is it's independent of xn plus 1. And this is essential for having an interpretation of this correlation function as the one in small universals. Yes. Exactly. So the last, so this is saying that this is consistent because we know that one psi we need for absorbing the zero. Okay. So if you take derivative solve of all the psi, the result should be zero. Which is not obvious from this formula. But nevertheless, it is true. Because if we take derivative with respect to all, if we apply a derivative operator on all the sides, okay, then we get a correlation function of the L sides. In the large Hilbert space, this correlation function should vanish because there is nothing to absorb the xi0. Okay. Last time I said that xi has a zero mode, okay, which can be absorbed by inserting a specific xi. Okay. But because the zero mode is a constant, del xi will not absorb xi0. And this is a reflection of this. Okay, that when we take this, the result becomes independent of x and so on. So the idea is that you take this as the correlation function in the large Hilbert space. But our interest is in constructing correlation function in the small Hilbert space, which involves only the operators beta, del xi, and eta, and nucleic phi's. And those are obtained by starting from this formula, taking the derivative with respect to all the xi except the last one, and then the result becomes independent of the coordinate of the last one. So you can just drop it. Okay? So you can declare that the small Hilbert space correlation function of L xi is obtained by starting with one extra xi inserted, taking the derivative with respect to all the other xi, and then just ignoring the fact that you have inserted one extra xi. Okay? So what I'll do is that I'll denote this by time. To denote that this is a correlation function in the large Hilbert space. When you talk about correlation function in the small Hilbert space, I will not explicitly insert the xi xn. Okay, I will just not display it because the result is independent of the coordinate of xi xn plus 1. But small Hilbert space means that all the other xi's that will appear in the, inside the correlation function will count the negatives. Okay, so that is how
ambiguity. Here, so it doesn't depend on n plus 1.
Yes.
Similar logic, it doesn't depend on any of the xi.
No, no. It doesn't depend on xn plus 1 only when you take the derivative versus all the other xi's.
Yeah, but I could just skip, say, x1.
Yes. Because it's symmetric, of course. In all the x's.
Right. All of them, when I think at once, what does it mean?
So that's in large Hilbert space. So what you do in a small Hilbert space, right? You have to see in a small Hilbert space, so you can calculate a correlation function. Okay. You don't see things like this.
Okay.
You have equal number of xi's and eta's.
Okay.
On all each of the xi's, you have a derivative. Okay. How do you get that correlation function from the formula that I have written? Okay. There are equal number of xi's and eta's, right? So it doesn't make sense to use this formula apparently. Okay. So what you do is that you take that formula, that correlation function that you want to calculate, equal number of xi's and eta's, or but each xi having a derivative, insert one more xi at some arbitrary point, xi of x star, and use this formula to calculate it. And this relation tells us that the final result will not depend on x star. Is this clear? Okay. Imagine, let me give an example. Suppose you want to calculate L xi of x theta of y in a small n. Okay, so no prime. How do you calculate this, given this formula? Okay. So you write this as I of x naught, del xi of x, theta of y, prime. Okay? Then you will write this as del x of xi of x naught, xi of x, theta of y, prime. delta of y cap. So this is del del x of, well, if you want me to write it, I can write it, but it is a readout from that. Right? You read out from this formula for that. For what it is. So that's how we'll calculate something like this on the small dimensions. This, yeah? Okay, that's the way you are supposed to make use of this formula.
Although this formula, all the xi's are in somewhat symmetric footing, when I use that, then x0 is somewhat special footing, but it doesn't matter.
Exactly, yeah, this is symmetric, but you apply, you put inside this x0, okay? And you can use a convention that, this is a sign convention, that whatever xi of x0 you use, you will use always in the front, to the xm level. Okay? Because every time you extend, there is a minus sign, right? So you can use the convention that it will always be on the xm.
Pardon?
Yes. No, because this is now independent of the x0, right? This is independent of x0. That's the state. So there is no singularity when x0 does anything. Okay? The I of x0 is needed for soaking on the 0. Is this clear? So this tells you how to calculate the psi in the phi correlation function. But now you see that there is a problem because all the singularities that are implied by OP are contained here. But there are also possible singularities on these vanishes. See, the theta function which is appearing in the denominator has zeros. And whenever this vanishes, you have a singularity. So these are what are called spurious poles. Okay, these are in fact the non-trivial kind of spurious poles. Okay, the trivial ones are the collisions of PCOs and collision of PCO is what it's about. So zeros of these are spurious poles. So these also happen for on surfaces of co-dimension 2, real co-dimension 2, right? Because vanishing of the theta gives a condition on the argument, right? A complex equation. This argument has to have some specific value, okay? Either 0 or half or tau by 2 or 1 plus tau by 2. And that means that there are two real conditions on the various variables. Those conditions now depend non-trivially on the locations of the operators as well as the motor line. Because when it vanishes, also depends on actually the motor line of the function, star, right? Some zeros of some of the theta functions are at tau y or 1 plus tau y. So these zeros involve non-trivially the locations of the PCOs and the motor line and the puncture locations. Because functions of course also carry into minus 5. So these are even very hard to locate where they are. Right? You have to really be careful, and I mean, you can't just geometrical picture it as the solutions of operators. But one unifying feature of all these previous schools is that all of them occur on codirection two subspaces, real codirection two subspaces of each unit. Okay, that's what we are going to make. Yes. Because theta function vanishes when the argument takes some specific value. Okay? For example, theta 1 1 vanishes at z equal to 0. Right? So that this has to be 0, right? Which is one complex equation. Right? So two real conditions, right? Or z equal to half, right? Or z equal to tau by 2, right? Which is still one complex equation, which is a real equation. So that's the general product.
Can you repeat why this is previous? Because apart from x not everything is
why this is?
Can you repeat why this is previous? Because I mean only x not is uncritical, but other x is or x is
no, this is previous because they are not implied by OPs. If I had just given you this correlation, this one, right? You could have looked at this and figured out certain similarities of this from the operator. When any of the xi's come close to y, when some of the zk's go near each other, there should be some singularity. Those are all captured here. Okay, the fact that when x goes close to y, there should be a pole, that's here. The xi, y, they vanish, right? When x goes to xi goes to y. These capture the appropriate operator product singularities when the z's come close to each other. These are not anticipated by any operator.
But these are physical, I mean, definition is previous, but
well, they are, meaning it depends on what is the definition of being physical, right? These are, in the interior of the modulized space, okay? These are singularities of omega b inside each here. Not from field theoretic interpretation, no. Not from field theoretic interpretation. The field theoretic interpretation only gives you near degeneration. Okay. But there's a worse understanding of all the spurious poles that I have discussed. Okay, so let me just say it, but you are not going to use it. Okay, because you are not starting from the worse and again supersymmetric worse theory and gauges. Okay. But if you did it, there is an interpretation of where this previous poles are coming from. And what one finds is that each of these previous poles now, let me say geometrically what this means. So, as I have been telling you, all the picture taking operators, okay, are coming because we have started with the Warship supersymmetric theory, okay, the local supersymmetric invariant theory, and we have gauge fields. So, we have gauge fields, the local supersymmetry to fix the gravity loads, yes, at delta function singularities, and then you have integrated out all the formulae. Now, if it so happens that the gauge fixing is not fixing the gauge completely, then we expect some problems. Okay? An analogy of this is on the sphere, right? An ordinary bosonic string theory on the sphere. When you gauge fix, okay, you have three gauge symmetries which are unfixed. Right? Those are the conformality limits of the sphere. Gauge fixing g alpha beta equal to delta alpha beta does it fix all the symmetries, right? And that's why we have, they show up as C0 modes. Okay, that's why you have 0 modes of the C host, and they cause 0 of the partial part. Right? If you don't insert the extra C's, you get C host. So whenever you have your gauge fixing is not complete, okay, you expect that in ordinary case you should get zeros. Why do you get zeros? Because you are dividing by the volume of the gauge group, right? And the volume of the gauge group becomes infinite. Okay, that's the SL2 R volume. Okay, or SL2 C volume, and that's what is causing the zero. Here the situation is opposite. Here, if the gauge fixing doesn't fix the gauge completely, what you get is not zero but infinite. Okay? Because you are fixing a formal expecting. Okay? So instead of dividing by the volume, okay, you are actually multiplying by the volume. Which shows up in the gauge independent formulation as a zero mode of gamma. And the gamma, once gamma zero develops a zero mode, the integration over the zero mode gives you infinity because it's a bosonic zero. And that is the origin of these divergences, and you can show that whenever the condition for a spurious singularity is satisfied, gamma develops a zero. Okay. The simplest one to understand is when two pictures and your operators collide. Okay. What is the meaning of when two pictures and your operators collide? This means that you are supposed to fix the gravity loss, okay, by putting certain conditions, right? And the locus of the picture changing operator is essentially the condition that the gravity law must vanish at that point. Okay, that's how the picture changing operator, so this is the interpretation of why the picture changing operator is inserted. So if you insert the picture changing operator at say k different places, okay, that means that you are gauge fixing the gravity law by imagining that it should vanish at those k different points. Now if those two of those points are the same, then you are putting redundant condition, right? The gravity law is not vanishing at distinct points, the gravity law is being forced to vanish at the same point, right? So the same condition you are applying twice. So that means that's not enough to fix the gauge. That's the simplest way to see why when two picture changing operators collide, you expect the same gravity. These are more complicated, but what can show that even when each of these spurious modes, whenever the denominator vanishes, you can show that reflects the fact that the gravity law or the gamma develops a zero. Singularities. Okay, but for us this is not going to be important. Okay, for us the only issue is that there are these spurious modes, how to deal with it. So how do we integrate? Then you find there is a solution to a killing equation. right? So similarly here, once you have inserted this, right, you are imposing certain singularity structure on the gammas, right? Gamma has certain zeros, certain poles, and so on. And now the question is, subject to this condition, is there a non-singular wave function for gamma? Okay, and you will find that when this condition for spurious poles are satisfied, you find there is a non-singular wave function for the gamma. You know, with these boundary conditions. And it's the integration now, so that means there is a gamma zero mode now. And the integration over the gamma zero mode causes the divergence. So these operators you think of as providing some boundary condition on the gamma, say, some certain singularity structure on the gamma.
And this integration is over the polarization to subspace.
Which integration?
The divergence.
Yeah. Yeah, so this divergence means that is zero. See,
this is the volume of the surface.
Yeah, this is the volume of the gamma zero. So that is not, see, that's just the integration about the gamma field, right?
Yeah.
That's what is causing divergence. Okay. It happens when these satisfy co-dimension 2 condition. See, it's exactly like if you have inserted three seeds on the sphere, right? If two of them are at the same point, you get a zero. Right. Why are you getting zero? Because you have not fixed the gauge completely. Right. You fix the gauge by requiring the C's has to vanish as Z1, Z2. But if Z1 and Z2 are the same, then the condition that you are putting on C is not strong enough for it to give a non-zero answer. Okay, C still has a zero. Right. And that's what makes this vanish. So it's the same thing here. That by inserting these operators, you have required that gamma has certain singularities. But the question is, are those singularities, okay, and zeros, what about the being, are those constraints enough to say that gamma has no zero on the plane? Okay, and what you find is that when the spurious pole condition is satisfied, gamma has a zero. Okay, and then the gamma integral in the path integral makes it divergent. And that happens when over at this 4-dimensional 2 subspace. That's true for C's also, right? If you have CZ1, CZ2, CZ3, right? Over a good amount of two subspaces, when Z1 and Z2 are equal, you get a zero. Okay, but as I said, none of this is just a physical interpretation of where it comes from. None of this is going to be important for defining the quadratic ramp. Because this is, after all, what the spurious poles are. Right? These three kinds of spurious poles. And our problem is how to integrate omega p to the spurious force. Irrespective of what the spurious force. If you don't fix the gauge completely, you will probably find superposed zero modes. Because this is, after all, you can think of this as a field theory. Okay, field theory, I don't know. You need local gauge invariance, right, which is formal. In supergravity, you will certainly have problems of this kind. Then in normal gauge theories, right? You may get zeros, but not infinites. Okay, so let's look at it somewhat geometrically. Okay, I'll have to draw a figure. Okay, I'll try to make it as simple as possible, but it will look a little more complicated than what we have been drawing so far. So now I'm going to draw PGMN again. Okay, but the base now I'll represent as a two-dimensional subspace. Dimensional space. However, as a one-dimensional fiber, labeled by the location of one of the picture changing components. Okay, this is just for simplification. Just draw a figure, one has to, I mean, you cannot draw any more than three dimensional figure. Okay. And so this is PGMN. And the spurious pole is a codimensional two subspace in this PGMN. Okay. So PGMN as I have drawn is three dimensional. Okay. So a spurious pole will correspond to a one dimensional curve passing through this. Okay. So take some one dimensional curve. And a section now is something that will go like this. Okay, so let's take a section. Maybe there is to draw a plane section that will make it clearer, but it doesn't have to be plain. So let's just for simplicity draw something that is parallel to this axis. Okay, think of this as a parallel to the PGMN. And PGMN is something that the spurious pole that we use a different color chalk for. This then it pierces through and comes out like this.
How do you know it's not parallel at some?
Pardon?
Maybe parallel also can.
Well, it could be, but that because that you have to be extremely lucky, right? Because in general the spurious pole, as you have seen, depends in a complicated way on the moduli and the location for the PC pole, right? So it doesn't have a simple structure that is parallel to this. If parallel is good, it's good enough. It's well and good, you don't have to do anything, right? But in general, that's not the case.
No, I think I have to know what's it does it, and then for some time it goes parallel. Nice.
Well, that's a very special case. See, I can have. But it doesn't matter. What analysis will cover that also. Okay. As long as it doesn't lie on the surface, okay, which is a very strange situation. Right? This is the generic situation, right? I mean, if it's parallel, see, the choice of section is always up to you, right? You can always fill the section so that it intersects. Okay, so this is the generic situation that you have to So here, there is a, as you can see, there is a problem because the integrand, when you try to integrate it over this section, is going to blow up here. Okay, because there is a hole. So the question is, how to choose a section so that we avoid the spurious. And you can see that it's not really possible in the generic situation to choose a section that avoids the spurious pole, right? Because you have to go from one side to the other, right? You cannot just avoid the spurious pole. So what we'll do is something else. We'll choose a section in a somewhat strange way. So let's cut out some disk on the surface where the spurious pole intersects this section. Here it's a zero dimensional point, right? On this two dimensional surface is four dimensional two, so it's a point at which the disk curve intersects. So cut out a disk on this surface around that point. And then go horizontal or down. Go sufficiently far up, okay. So our section that we will be choosing is now this part, everything that is outside this disk. Then the surface of the cylinder, okay, so you can see that it is not strictly a section, okay, because it is going vertically up. And then this place. Pardon? Yeah, it still touches the card, but it touches it as it's going vertically up. Right? That's the important. Okay, it has to. So you choose the medium. So is this picture clear? Right? So we have a two-dimensional plane, and there is a point here where the spurious pole is spurious singularity is intersecting the plane. Right? So you cut out, you draw a circle around that point. Okay? It doesn't have a circle. Draw some card around that circle. Then erect a cylinder vertically, okay, and fill it here. Okay, and make sure that you go sufficiently high up so the spurious pole has one out on the substance. Is this clear? Okay, this will fail only if it's vertically up. Right? If this is vertically up. But that's not the situation ever, because if the spurious pole is like this, that means what? That the location of the spurious pole is independent of Z1. Right? For all Z1 it exists. But all the spurious poles that we have seen, right, depends on some PCO load. Right? The spurious pole comes with another PCO. Either the PCOs are colliding, or the PCO is colliding with the vortex of water, or this where things depend on the PCO locations. So it always depends on some PCO location. And that PCO is what I call Z1.
Dr. Take a different section.
Pardon?
Dr. Take a different section.
Yeah, you could take a different section, but what I'm saying is that if this had been vertically up.
Yeah, so if it's a different section, then it is not vertically up.
No, no. So, suppose the this yellow card was vertically up, like this.
Yeah.
Right? Then it's not possible to cut it by vertical section. See, what I want to do is that I want to cut the spurious pole by a vertical segment along which Z1 is bearing, keeping the motor like this.
Vertical with respect to the section, right?
No, not vertical with respect to the section. Vertical means only along the fiber direction. That there is one tangent vector which is purely along the fiber direction. So this surface has that feature, right? That one of the tangent vectors of the surface, okay, is purely along the fiber direction. Okay, that is going to be important. That will not happen if this is going vertical.
And you do not need a connection for this break.
No, because the point is that the change in Z1, keeping the moduli fixed, is a well-defined concept. Changing the moduli keeping Z1 fixed is not a well-defined concept. But you can certainly keep the moduli fixed and change Z1. Right? You can move in the fiber direction at a fixed value of the base, point in the base. Right? The other way is not possible. There is no infinite. What do you mean by
that?
Yeah, in this case not FIJ, that's the location of the PCO. Okay? We are not changing local coordinates, we are just changing the PCO location. Now it's not clear at this stage that it helps. Okay? So I have to show that it helps in defining the amplitude.
The cylinder is now part of a section?
Or? Yes, the cylinder is part of the integration variable. So the full integral, so if you call this region S1, these are S2, and the cylinder is C. Then the full integration, so it's not a general, it's not a section anymore. Okay? Because sections don't go vertically up. But it's some subspace of PGMN, right? And I have defined the omega p of PGMN. So I can certainly integrate the omega p over this. Right? As long as you can avoid the, as long as you can show that the spurious singularities don't bother us, right? We can certainly integrate omega PGMN, omega GMN on. So let me just say that we have to integrate over. Integrate over S1 plus S2 plus C plus S. You come like this, go up, and then fill up. In this case, this is closed. Yes.
But
the cylinder will close. Yes, yes. So that we have to deal with. Okay, I'm going to tell you how to deal with this. So the geometric picture that I have drawn hasn't solved the problem, right? It has just transferred the problem into the cylinder. Okay, so after I'll specify, after I'll say how we deal with the spurious code on the cylinder. Is this clear? Okay. So in this way, there's no problem in defining the integrals on S1 and S2. Right? Because there are no but interference to S2. The possible problem is about the cylinder. So let's call this base B. Okay, or maybe it's projection. It's projection on empty element. Okay, so we characterize this. So let's call this. This is B, this is B prime. And what should I call this? Let's call it some B delta. This is a projection on the base, so you are just cylinder is a vertical segment erected over the cylinder. Okay, which is like this.
Can you explain once more why you have drawn that extra line?
Which extra line? This one?
No. The MGN originally had this one line, MGN and
TTN,
right?
MGN had
additional draw.
Well, I was drawing it to dimensional graph, but of course MGN is high, I mean 60 minus 6 plus 2 plus 2 in dimensional, right? So I have drawn it here as 2 dimensional because I have to show, because see the spurious pole is a 2 dimensional subspace, right? So if I draw it as a 1 dimensional section, then I cannot draw the spurious pole position on that, right? To draw a 2 dimensional 2, I need at least a 2 dimensional subspace, right? That's the reason I have drawn it as a 2 dimensional subspace, 2 dimensional space, right? So that the geometric picture is clear. No, it will not be 0. I'll write down what it is, right? It's not 0. Because that omega doesn't have a 0 here. So how do you want to do this to integrate over C of omega? 6 G minus 6 plus 3 plus 1.
What is the yellow line on the B?
This is the projection of this on MGA, right? So this both B and B tilde, B prime, are basically pulled back. I mean, so B tilde is a coord, so you can see, think of this as being leveled by the coordinates B tilde, coordinates on B tilde. See, draw this circle on MGA, right? So this is, these are points in TG, I mean, you can always project it down to MGA, right?
Okay, but that
would
be just one point now, right?
One point? No.
No.
Why one point? Because this whole, this thing isn't projected now.
This circle or the?
This circle, this circle.
But then there will be two points, like many points in fact. At each point there will be many Z1s, right?
Yes, yeah, so all of those Z1s, mm-hmm. right? Project onto the same point on this, right? That's a, so that's the distinction between this vertical section, right? See, normally the part of this will project down to the whole of MGA, I mean the total dimension of the space on which, if you take some segment of this, right, it will project down to a 6G minus 6 plus 2M plus 2N dimensional subspace of this. Okay? Except the cylinder. Okay? Because the cylinder is going vertically up, okay? One of the directions of the cylinder is just a tangent, that this tangent vector is moving only in the fiber direction. Okay? That's why the projection of the cylinder on MGMN, okay, is one dimension less. That's why it looks like a chord instead of a plane. Instead of a two dimensional subspace. Okay? Again, this is projected onto in the integral. Okay, so this integral has a factor structure that we can, the way we can do the integral is that we take point by point on the base and first carry out integration over this direction, the z1 direction. So suppose z1 is equal to z1 hat at the bottom and there won't be land at all. These could be functions coordinate on B theta.
For some you mean on this one, I mean on the vertical boundary of
on this, yes. On this B. So B and B prime, right? Or maybe I can say B hat and B theta. It'll make it clear. Okay? The 0 1 value is here, 0 1 value here is 0 1 hat. Here it's 0 1 theta. Okay? And there is no reason why the 0 1 value has to be the same everywhere. In fact, it doesn't make sense, right? Because these are, as you move in this direction, it doesn't make sense to say whether the z1 is the same one. So that's why this z1 hat and z1 theta could be functions of the coordinate on the base. Okay, it will not make a difference. But let's first try to do the ordinary integration. Okay, the z1 direction. Now for that, what we have to do? We have to look inside omega and identify the part of omega which has a dz1, right? If you have to integrate over the z1 direction, see that's the tangent vector, right? So you have to find a contraction of omega with del del z1 to be able to integrate over this vertical cylinder. In other words, to get a non-zero answer of omega g when you integrate over this cylinder, we have to pick the contribution to omega that is proportional to dz1. Is that clear? See, let's imagine that there is some surface, right? One of the tangent vectors of the surface is purely along x1 direction. Okay? So unless you pick omega, may have many components, right? dx1 as dx2, dx1 as dx3, dx2 as dx3. But dx2 is dx3, but will not contribute to the integral, right? If you have one of the tangent vectors directed along x1. So similarly here, because one of the tangent vectors is directed along z1, we have to pick the dz1 component of omega. Is this clear? Yes, that's right. Yeah. So well, for fixed, the point is for a fixed value, fixed point here. So you go up from here to here. Right? This is z1 tilde, this is z1 hat. When you go from here to here, you again do this integral first.
No, I'm saying at each point of this B, the value is z1 hat. Each point of B tilde, the value is z1 hat.
Not necessarily the same. I have, because I don't draw it, I have really drawn it as parallel.
Yeah,
to the base. But in general it's OM.
But this case.
Yeah, in this case it looks the same in the in this coordinate system. Because but that's completely artificial.
Yeah, because here for it, here drawn in parallel.
Yeah, I've drawn it parallel. But in general it will OM, right? And the Z1 hat here will be varying, Z1 tilde here will be varying in general.
On the top of the cylinder you
have I've drawn it vertical, but it's not necessary. You could have, I mean the cylinder could be a complicated shape like this here and here, right? I mean, the cylinder could be like this.
Polygon this is true.
Yeah. So all I need is that the spurious pole goes up the one. Okay, I still have to explain why this is helpful. Okay, that will be clear.
So, you, one of the properties of omega.
Yes.
Where you inform that a transversal that must be along the GG base, I want to say.
Yes.
That should be omega p if you want to do that.
That should be zero. What is it? Yes. This is reparametrization of the same. It's not moving movement of the fiber. This is, we are not reparametrizing anything, right? See, that was in the context of when you are trying to reparametrize the local coordinate system on each coordinate. This is actually Galois motion in the fiber, right? So it's actually not going to be zero. In fact, we wrote down what it is, right? So what is the part of omega that is proportional to dz1. In fact, there is only one source of dz1, if you remember, because in the definition of omega p, it has a correlation function of various things, and it has a product of x of zi minus del xi of zi dzi. Okay, wave product, in the sense of wave product, and then various other things. So this is the source of dz1. Okay, so this means that if we want to get a non-zero answer from this, you can divide this integral into two parts. Okay, one is the integration over, say, the base, right? The base bond, let me call it by integrated by B field. Okay, this is a pullback of the normal one. Pardon?
The cap of the cylinder, the depth boundary is also called B tilde, and the projection on the base also B tilde.
Oh, so this is something else. So it's called B bar. This part is actually not very relevant. I'm just pulling the omega on the base. But what's important is that the integration over the C, this part involves just del xi z1 dz1. Is this clear? And you can see that there is no place, no other part of, once you have pulled out this minus del xi z1 dz1, nothing else depends on z1. Right? Because only z1 dependence was coming from this factor. Right? Once you have put the minus x z1 dz1, the xz1 has got disappeared. Right? You can also pick xz1. Okay, in this program. So, we pick minus del xi z1 dz1, and then there is no, this part is completely independent of z1 part. So, it can just come out of the same integral. Okay, that's the only important part of this argument. Okay? That the z1 dependence is here. And then whatever is coming out here is independent of z1, and that's why I have taken it out of the integral of C. But this I can now write. So this is running from z1 hat to z1 tilde, right? Z1 tilde. So this I can write as I of z1 hat minus I of z1.
Z1 hat of this coordinate, they don't have a B bar. They don't have
also
depends on.
Yes, exactly. So these depend on B bar. It is the, as you vary over the base, then the Z1 has to vary. Is this point clear? But the important point is that it only depends on two endpoints. Okay, going to the integral.
That is also V bar, coordinates on V bar.
Yes, so they don't have the function of V bar, yeah. Coordinates on V bar, right? So basically after you have done this, the xi of z1 tilde minus xi of z1, right? You integrate over this.
Yes.
Right? So because you have to integrate over the whole cylinder, right? You have done this part of the integral, and then you have to integrate over this.
Z1 is not a part of MPN, right?
Z1 is not part of, no, Z1 is not part of MPN, but once you have chosen this section, right, Z1 is a function of coordinates of MPN, right? Because you look at this picture, for any given point here, right, you go up, and you, Z1 hat by definition is this point, right? So, corresponding to this point on MCN, okay, the corresponding Z1 hat is this one. See, because they are integrating over this base. See, I have introduced this B bar just so that I can pull back the whole omega on the B bar. Then I can think of this integration over the cylinder as an integration over B bar and then integration over the Z1. Okay. That integration is being done from Z1 hat to Z1 tilde, each of which are functions of the coordinate of the base, because if you go to a different point here, right, on this B1, you will get a different Z1 hat and Z1 tilde.
the z1 has a pullback on MTM.
Yeah, exactly. So you are pulling back z1 hat and z1 tilde on MTM. So now we see what is the final structure. The final structure of the correlation function that we are getting is that we will get a set of operators where xi is inserted here or xi is inserted here. But it has no knowledge about what happened in between. Right? Even though the spurious pole has passed through, it doesn't know about it.
Omega doesn't have any leg in the direction of this line,
why is it? Yeah, because I could do the z1 integral without worrying about any other integrals going on at the same time. Right? This has to do with the fact that if we have integral a to b, the derivative of a function, then this function, it may have poles elsewhere, poles in the way. This integral is independent of those poles. It doesn't get affected by those poles. So in a sense, this is the way we define the integral over C. The integral over C will be defined as just xi of z tilde minus xi of z hat. Okay? You can also think of this as, now you may worry that xi of z1 hat and xi of z1 tilde are not in the small hyperspace, right? Okay? The difference of course is the small hyperspace. Okay? So we can rewrite this as z hat to z tilde del xi of z dz. And the essential point that we are using here is that this integral that I have taken doesn't depend on the path that I take from there to z. Okay, it's well defined because of this fact that this is well defined expression. Okay, I didn't have to say anything about the path. This integral doesn't depend on the path, even though xi is not a physical operator in that spot. This, in fact, is the crucial ingredient of this construction. If you recall, somebody asked during the discussion whether you could have thought about whether you can forgotten about xi altogether and use eta and del xi as independent variable. Right? Or equivalently, you could have taken e to the q phi, beta and gamma as independent variables. Right? You could certainly do that. You could write down all the correlation functions involving e to the q phi, beta and gamma. Okay. And you could define xi, del xi, by taking the beta of z would be the phi of w of p. Okay. Because beta after all is del xi equal to minus phi. Okay. So if you take the op of the beta of z to be phi of w, you will recover your del xi. But from that definition, it will not at all be obvious that when you integrate del xi defined this way, along a curve, the result is independent of the curve on which you integrate. It's not true for generic dimension one current, right? If you take g of z with the dimension one current, okay, you integrate over various curves, you'll get different answers because g of z has both. Right? So, yes. In fact, this result is even stronger, right? It's highly dependent on the poles. Right? On the poles, for example, or in generic genus in one surface, it doesn't depend on which cycle you integrate. When you integrate from z hat to z tilde, right, you could go around different cycles of the torus. Okay, you could still give the same answer. Because this is periodic. This is all the periodicity property that the correlation function is supposed to have. So because of this, once you have taken this vertical cylinder, integral over this direction, okay, is completely well defined. And that's what you can use to define the integration over the cylinder C. Okay, because once you have written it as this difference, now there is no similarity anywhere. You can integrate over this and get the result for NTS over the same. Yes, that's right.
This restriction we have to do that because there is this.
Yes, that's
the information should be contained in the field.
Well, you could still do this. I mean, nothing prevents you from doing this even when there is no codivalence of two singularity. Somewhere in the middle of the modular space, you may decide that you want to go up for some reason.
Yes, but there it doesn't make any difference whether I can, you know, whether I go or not in different answers.
Well, you will get different answers because you, it's a different section altogether, right? It's a different generalized section, so the off-scale amplitude will be different. Right? The on-scale amplitude will not be different. Right? By Stokes' theorem. And the point is that the Stokes' theorem applies irrespective of whether it's a regular section or not. Right? So this is after all the subspace of PGMA, right? And to apply Stokes' theorem, that's all you need. Right? You don't need that it has to be a section, that it can have vertical parts like this. Right? Normal sections don't have vertical parts like this. Right? Because given a point on the base, okay, there's every point in the file. That's how you define a section, right? Here you see that that's not true. Given this point in the base, there are many points in the file. Right? And that's what we are interested in. Okay? So it's not a section in an usual sense. Okay? But for all the identities you have derived, right, we have never really used the fact that we need a section. Right? All you have used in applying the Stokes theorem is that we need a subspace of PGMN that we integrated, right? A connected subspace. It shouldn't have gaps. Is this point clear? Now, you can think of it in this way, in the way I described, okay, that you have vertical segments on which you integrate. But you can also think of it in a different way. Okay, you can think of it that you will divide the moduli space into different regions, and on different regions you will choose different sections, okay, leaving some gaps, okay. And whenever there is a gap, you have to add some correction, and those correction terms are these integrals. Those correction terms are integrals of psi of z1 f minus psi of z1 tilde, okay, integral over the boundary, right. So here, over this b bar, you made a jump, right? It failed to be a section over b bar, right? I mean, outside it's a section, regular section, inside it's a regular section. Over b bar, you made sudden jumps in the fiber direction. Okay? So you integrate over outside in a regular fashion, you integrate over inside in a regular fashion, and over the base, over this in one subspace, okay, you add a correction term. Okay? And that correction term is given the integral of omega p. Okay, so what is the correction term? Correction term is integral over b bar of omega tilde. Omega tilde 6 e minus 6 plus 2m plus 2n minus 1. Okay, we have lost one of the directions. And what is omega tilde? This is obtained from omega by dropping x of z1 minus the exact of z1 is equal. Okay, and multiplying by, that's important, and multiplying by psi of z1 hat, psi of z1 hat minus psi of z1. Is this clear? Okay, so let me repeat again. So what you are supposed to do? In this region, you take the regular pullback of omega 6 g minus 6 plus 2m plus 2n, okay, from PGMN onto MGMN by using the section. This part of the section, section S1. In the interior, you pull back omega 6 g minus 6 plus 2m plus 2n onto MGMN using this section. And then we add a collection term on the base. The collection term on the base is the pullback not of omega but of omega tilde using this part of the section. Okay, omega tilde has one less dimension. Not omega tilde. Omega tilde, of course, you can define omega tilde for all p. Okay, just like you define omega for all. But the particular dB that we need for the integrating our base, okay, has one less dB because it's a one less dimensional subspace. Okay. And omega tilde is constructed simply by dropping this part from the definition of omega and putting back its I from 0 at minus I. Is this clear?
So for this integral to be well defined, you have to make sure that the vertex operators don't come near to this particular range of z.
Yes. So the vertex operators come near this particular range. Right? That's like collision of a picture changing operator to the vertex operator. That's also a spurious singularity from this perspective. You will avoid those by using exactly the same. Because the point is that from whatever you have done, you are not restricted to spurious singularities of this kind. Right? Anytime you find that there is a singularity in the integral, which is not because of degeneration, you do this. You stop integrating outside a certain base and then go vertically up, go to a region where the spurious singularity has gone out. And then you fill the section. Right? And in general, because there are many chord samples, right? There's not one spurious singularity, there are many spurious singularities, right? So there you have many hot particle sections like this. Okay? In fact, we'll give the general procedure next time. Okay? Where you will basically triangulate the moduli space and use various sections in various parts and add collections at all. Yeah, for the, if we didn't know that the correlation function of psi in the large Hilbert space is a well-defined object, right? Which is equivalent to saying that if we didn't know the integral of del psi is independent of the path, we couldn't have tackled this problem. Right? And as I said, it's very hard to understand the origin of this identity just for the beta gamma phi system. Right? If you have taken beta gamma and you U phi as an independent variable, right? You could have defined that del psi by taking the OP of beta with e to the minus phi or e to the phi. But to prove from there that the del psi correlation function is independent of the path, right? Then the del psi integral would have been very difficult. Because it's not derivative of anything, right? When you take the OP of beta of z with e to the minus phi of W, right? Nobody tells you that the product is derivative of anything. In fact, it's not derivative of anything in the small universe space. Okay. So, the crucial ingredient here is that there is a large Hilbert space, okay, and that there is a well defined set of correlation functions for the large Hilbert space. Okay. The only problem is that it has various poles. But this correlation function has all the correct periodicities and it's single value. Okay. And that's what we are using. This. So maybe I'll stop here and then.